forms the uncountable species that have been created by the ultimate reality, the composite rational and advanced level of animal which we call as a human being. He is said to be swept in such a stage wherein by he can realize the goal and purpose of his life. And not only realizing by his own self, but also he is having such a capability of uplifting his fellow beings, as well as serving as a reservoir of knowledge, service towards the whole system of the ecos and cosmos. Manasaha Yishitri Buddhi Tadvan Marishinaha. Everybody, they have instincts. All living organisms, Pranina Buddhijivinaha, the specialized creatures which are driven by their instincts, the operations on the basis of their instincts, that too limited, basic and rudimentary instincts such as appetite, fear, union, all of these instincts are very common with all living beings. And in advanced level of these instincts, what we define now and we conduct the seminars upon the realization of the same, that is the values. Basically, each and every person having an appetite by which he consumes food and thirst by which he drives himself to take water, and the natural surroundings of the person which tempts him to seek a shelter, a comfort, and the advanced level of comfort known as luxury, all of these pleasures are instinctive in nature. And whenever these things are broadened, deepened, and high advanced, these instincts are converted into values. And even though human beings are considered to be advanced organisms in the creature's level, but still the real humanitarian standard and precision is laudable or appreciable only the instincts are concerned with the level of values when they are evaluated with the principles of magnanimity, truth, perfection, and their derivatives. So in this context, even though there may be thousands of millions of myriads of varieties, kinds, and quantities of species observable, only few people, only few sectors, only few countable elements are there with values. Those who can realize values, those who can recognize values, and those who can relish values. It needs a different level of apprehension. Just as we know that to distinguish a stone from a quartz from a crystal, and crystal from a diamond, it requires a special way of attention with a prudential pursuit, applying the rules of gemology, by which its genuinity, its greatness, everything can be evaluated. Likewise, values cannot be very much appreciated or apprehended by people who are clouded with the murky illusory instincts of worldliness. Even though the basic instincts are unavoidable, even to the utmost realized souls of the earth, being born as a compendium, being born as a compendium of the material elements and compilation of the variable instincts over the time immemorial, successes of births and deaths in the perpetual maya samsara are the illusory bondage. It is unavoidable for a person to be instinct free, but still having the basic operation of instincts, an advanced level of thinking by which a person, instead of being self-centric, in which the person demands his own benefits, which expands and extends towards his family, his well-wishers, his business. So it extends to a self-centric phenomenon by which a person is concerned with him as well as those who are concerned with him. So one who is concerned about him as well as concerned about those who are concerned about him. So it is a self-centric, demarcated way of an instinctive life. And only gifted people, those who are blessed with benevolence, those who have been gifted with the gracious benedictions of sadhus, the realized personalities, supreme personalities, either by birth or by association or by erudition or by realization or by observation of austerity, penance, mysticism and various other methodologies, they get this spark by which the spirit is ignited, which turns into an effulgent radiance, comforting the spirit, resulting in inexhaustible bliss, which is distributed to the wholesome society. Only all people are there. We know that All people are there. All animals are there. How is construed is sacred. There are innumerable botanical species. Tulsi is very much applauded. It is considered to be very much holy and sacred by these cultures. So, likewise, all are human beings, and all human beings do the same thing which is repetitively done by the yesteryears in the previous birth cycles. These things are very monotonous. In spite of which, it is an opportunity rendered by God by which, just as a person failed in an examination, he is given an opportunity for a second attempt. Those who have failed in the human endeavors to achieve the humanitarian consideration by which they can proceed to the divine kingdom, so as they can totally, consummately uplift and vitalize the society, the fellow beings, so as resulting in all round success and happiness. It is an opportunity extended once more to do it more perfectly, to do it more precisely, to also associate with other people so that it can be led with a vehement force. So it is a very rare opportunity. That too, as rightly told by the people, the elect and the eminent personalities spoken before, it is a rare opportunity to be born here, because everybody, you know, that they have instincts and somebody have advanced instincts known as values. These values, basically, they start with compassion. Compassion is the first basic value. It is the first spirit which makes the persons to understand the society. And second thing is service or mercy or benevolence or broad mindedness is the first requisite which attempts you, which allows you to understand God. Enthusiasm or curiosity, it is the initial spirit which makes you to understand science. So, each and every area, either it may be science, the first S, the society, the second one, or the spirituality, the third one, it starts with a small force which ignites and which results in the proceedings and the success at the ultimate level. So, enthusiasm, service-mindedness, these are all the basic qualities which allows you to develop it in such a very smooth level, colossal level, by which you get all-round success and prosperity. And you know that there were great thinkers. Some people, they thought in their innovative approach of their epistemological values, they were in the scientific field, understanding or trying to understand the forces of nature like magnetism, the nuclear science or the nuclear power, the radioactivity, the semiconductors, the ultrasonics, the unseen radars and unseen x-rays and all other things of forces, the forces of nature. Somebody were in the pursuit of that. Somebody were in the pursuit of the chemical components of that. Somebody about the living organism, that genetic engineering and the genetic evolution. So each and everybody, on the basis of the rightly told, the three primordial compositions, the Triguna, what we call in Sanskrit, Triguna Atmika, Trigunya, that is a proportion of Satvika, goodness, Rajasa, passion, and Tamasa, ignorance. Based on the proportionate value and the directive principles of approach and appreciation as well as application, the person tends to know things, to realize things, to rejoice things, to apply things, and to achieve and enjoy things. So each and everything is very much controlled by these three primordial proportionate values, which are once again based on a person's karmika bandha, the person's imprints and impulses of his purva bandha, which is initiated and instigated by a supreme force known as Brahman. So each and everybody in this world, they have some temptation to know about the society or the surroundings, which is known as vijnana. The person interested in self-introspection and realization, that is samjnana. The person who is very much interested and committed in knowing about the binding spirit, the super engineer, the master mind, the ultimate, the spirit of the world, the eternity and truth, what we call by different names in different scriptures. So the person comes to understand that thing which is known as prajna. So being led by this proportion of these three, the person is tempted to know variety of things depending upon the qualitative and quantitative proportionate availability of his karmic level, which is that manifested in the form of his intellectual pursuit and journey. In this, the whole world, you know about the great Greek philosophers and creative thinkers like Plato, Aristotle, then Socrates and also Thomas Aquinas, then John Hobbes, Immanuel Kant. There were lot of uncountable creative thinkers. Just as we had lot of saints, sages, seers, scholars and stalwarts, the whole world, they indubitably comprised of varieties of people thinking about various of things. But what is the difference about the people who have been born in this land, the Bharat, the Jambudvipa, and how they are distinct distinguished and distinguishable from the other people of the world. It has been told in the Shastras, the way of understanding the ultimate reality, the pursuit of understanding the fundamental unit of the world, it cannot be gained by three things. One is by a logical pursuit, that is known as pravachana. Second is by medha. What is medha? Medha is intellectual approach or intellectual exercise by which a person keeping on thinking, keeping on repeating things, or keeping on reiterating things, that is known as medhas. Finding out the fundamental by an intellectual exercise. And third thing is bahushruta. What is bahushruta? Exposure and experience. The whole world comprised of varieties of thinkers. And those thinkers, they were based on just an intellectual exercise. That is application of their intellectual standard by the theory of mental aptitude, logical reasoning, apprehending thing by comparative evaluation. So all of these things are intellectual exercises. Whereas the Brahman or ultimate reality must be realized by means of a self-introspection, and the applications must be in the form of a great way which we call as penance, austerity and the other relative mystic properties. So Nayamatma Pravachanena Labhya Amedhaya Bahuna Shudena is a Vedic statement. The ultimate truth cannot be understood by your logical knowledge, your theoretical knowledge, or by exposure and experience. So the greatest thinkers of the world, they went by logics, they went by intellectual pursuit and analytical and comparative evaluation, in which they failed or they were very much held up at a very limited and demarcated step. Whereas these people of the land, like Parashara, Vyasa, Prajapati, Kashyapa, Kanva, Pulastya, Agastya, Shakti, then Shuka Brahman, various these people, they pondered upon the ultimate spirit through their Dharma Shastras, through their Vedic pursuit, or through their Samhitas, Itihasa Purana. So these various manifestations of the realization that shows how deep they have understood, not by their self-effort, just as the Westerners they have done, which shows limitation. They have done it with the grace of the God. So a person who has understood that he cannot understand Brahman has understood. A person who claims that he has understood has not. Yasya matam tasya matam, matam yasya navedasaha, avijnatam vijanatam, vijnatam avijanatam. So here the people of this land, they accepted their limitations, the demarcations of their intellect, of their imagination, of their executive skill, and by surrender and penance, they got that knowledge which is blemishless, all productive and perennial. Whereas the other people, they went for self-endeavor. Self-endeavor towards understanding such an inexhaustible and unlimited infinity is just like trying to measure either the sky or the ocean with the limited palm or your hand scale. So this approach of surrender and penance was the greatness of our land, in which we are distinct, distinguished and distinguishable from the people. So we are very much proud to be born in this land. And the pride is restored and resurrected if it is understood, pride, and distributed to the connective mass. Otherwise, all of these decorations of technological, scientific, social, luxury and other connective developments of the society, it is just like a decoration to a corpse if they are not vivified with the development of the ethical, moral, spiritual and cultural standards. So, taking this into consideration, only a few people, manushyanam sahasreshu kaschit yata disiddhaye. So, at the time of the presence of the direct incarnation of the Supreme Krishna, if there are only a few people in his absence, especially in this Kali Yuga, so many people will be there, we can just imagine it. There are few people, and those few people, they must be nourished with the support from the society, they must be patronized from the society, they must be very much associated with the like-minded spirits. We used to always say that all the negative forces, they are very much integral, mutually very much associative, and mutually they are having a lot of apprehensions and integrities. Whereas these positive forces, they are always ever scattered. Always there is an ego clash between positive forces. All destructive forces unanimously, they work together for destructive purposes. Whereas the constructive forces, they are lack of this integrity. So all of these people, very limitedly available at this age of Kali, which we call as an age of debilitation of dharma. But still we can understand that whenever there is a disease inside your body, whenever there is a negative element, foreign element, alien entering inside the body, the natural resistance system that produces the best possibility from your body to fight against those elements and to see that they are extirpated. Likewise, in this Kali only, we had, can you list the name of such great Mahapurushas in Krita Yuga? You cannot name more than 10 people. In Treta and Dwapara Yuga, you cannot name more than 10 or 20 people. In Kali Yuga, you can name hundreds and thousands of great people. Because whenever there is a deterioration destined, a negativity that is going to rule and manipulate the society, the cosmic resistance, the global resistance, the eco or cosmo-psychical system that secretes, that emanates a type of resistant energy which emanates in the production of the best possible relievers, saviors of the society. So that is the greatness of, that is what we call blessing in disguise. Even though Kali is considered to be a very deplorable and despicable age, as this age deserves and urgently needs so many saviors to look after and to uplift the humanity which is drowned in illusion, without any solution, it produces the best people. So Kali Yuga is an age where we can get the best possible people being produced by the eco-physical resistance system of the globe. Likewise, great people have been produced in this land, either in innovative field, in social service, in upliftment field, in the theological field, in philosophical pursuit. Lot of people like social reformers, religious reformers, socio-religious reformers, then relievers from the problems of political, economical and other related things are there. Now more the world is expanding, the problems are also expanding. The more the problems are expanding, the more solutions are also automatically separated. It is a natural rule. But what is our duty if everything is natural? What is our duty? It is our duty to be associated with the natural phenomenon with utmost dedication and service mindedness. That is our duty. So this laudable project, this laudable institution with the greatest and meritorious principles by which they wanted to establish the human values, spirituality, then we shall lead to the integrity and peace of the society. So, human values, first thing is human value, as being told by somebody else, it may not serve as four pillars of the society. It is a single tree with four portions. Everything starts with value. Everything starts with value. Value starts with sacrifice. If a person considers value, see, comfort and principle, luxury and rule, morality and mundanism, they cannot coexist. Unless the person is enhanced to such a level of giving preference, just as a person gives preference, you see, a person gives preference to wealth, but if a sharp knife is kept in his throat for getting his wealth, considering his life as wealth, he will sacrifice that wealth. So if great people, if their honor, privilege and prestige, if it is put to a threat, then they are ready to lose even their life for the prestige of life. So values differ on circumstances and contextual, that is what we call contextual significance. Likewise, each and everything is great, but they are based upon their contextual significance. Likewise, no doubt, values are great, but these values, they form the fundamental of the society, but they can be realized and relished by only some people, those who are blessed, those who are gifted to realize and release it. The persons who are blinded with passion, the persons who are blinded with the basic, mundane and principleless instincts of avarice, lust, illusion and the way they are the directive results. They cannot be a good receptacle of the values as well as the value-based system of life. So these values, they form the basic root of the tree of the society. And these human values culminate at the spiritual realization. Nobody can get the spiritual perfection. Nobody can get the spiritual perfection unless they are based on human values. If somebody is not human, how they can be para-human to become a divine receptacle or to become a divine agent? See, loving God is entirely different. You can love God because He is going to totally uproot your miseries and He is a bestower of pleasures to you. You can love God. But that is not going to be efficacious. The real efficacy comes when you are being loved by God. It does not come in you are loving God or you are catching of His feet. His embrace on you. his approach and his affection on you is really going to give the fruit. So if your real fruit or your real benefit is getting the pleasures, you must be loved by the God. If you want to get benefits from God, you must be loved by him. If you want to love by God, then certainly you must have at least a pinch of godliness, the qualities of God, like mercy, magnanimity, charity, purity, self-restraint, all of these principles. God is an abode of all of these principles. He is an opulential depository of all of these transcendental qualities. At least you must possess a negligible infinitesimal portion of it. Otherwise you will not be loved by God. So the human values form the fundamental foundation which sprouts and germinates into spiritualism, which branches into integrity, the common binding instinct of the society. Each and everybody in a train or bus, they will be talking about lot of these things. They will be having different thinkings. They won't even talk with each other. But if the bus is in accident, if it is in fire, all the people will be subjected to a common binding instinct, CBI, and they will all try to just jump out. Likewise, we may be having different goals, different principles, and different diversities. It is very hard, even theoretically or practically, to unify all languages or all religions. These things are just words. But still, we can have a common binding instinct. That is a personal thing that I worship a God. I believe in the principle of Vishishtadvaita, or I follow the footsteps of Ramanujacharya. But that does not mean that being the fellow denizen of this world, it is my duty to serve the people. It is my personal principle, and no way it is going to hinder the extension of my fraternity to have a global citizenship, to have a global understanding and communion. It is not going to hinder in any way. So it is going to branch out in the form of integrity, and which is going to flower and give the fruit of peace. So the basic root of the society is human values, and that germinates in the form of spirituality, that is going to branch, bud and flower in the form of integration of the society if all committed people are unified together. I used to say basically two things. The only strength of negative forces is they are united. Even though they are 10 people, they are united. The only drawback of positivity or precision or religiosity or morality is they are unorganized and disintegrated. These are this thing, negativity has only one plus and positivity has only one minus, that is lack of integration. So if the speech is over, then we have our own life, which we call as the real life, even though scripture says that this is the real life, in which there is pursuit of truth, pursuit of peace, this is the real life, and that is a stage drama. But we have been very much accustomed to think that this is a part of life, it is a pinch of life, or it is a spark of life, and that is a real life. So we used to misconceive this thing. So if that is over, how many people they are going to think? How many people are going to distribute? How many people are going to organize activities or seminars or personal introspections about these values of integration, peace, religiosity, the spiritual values or human beings? How many people they have the continuity? How many people have the incessant pour? How many people have the outpouring or genuine feeling that they have to organize and assemble the same thing in the life? So unless this thing is carried out, just as even though you are crossing the threshold, you must be carrying this idea in your heart. And wherever you go and whatever you do, you must do with the spirit of establishing this tree, which is going to give the shadow of comfort and peace to the whole world. Narayana.